Welcome back to another episode of Introductory Organic Chemistry. Today we're going to talk about carbonyl reductions to methylenes using the Mozingo, Wolff-Kischner, and Clemmensen reduction. But before we get into that, let's go through the practice problems I assigned last lecture. Now, you may recall that last lecture we talked about electrophilic aromatic substitution reactions, EAS reactions. Now, in this case, we have a nitrile, which is an electron withdrawing group. That means that it's a metadirector. Additionally, we have this ether, which tends to be a para or ortho director. So we would usually anticipate that an electrophile is going to be added to the ortho position. Now in this case, NCS stands for N-chlorosuccinamide. So what we're going to get is we're going to get chlorination ortho to the ether, which is also meta to the nitrile. So this is a really well-selected reaction. Now in this next reaction, we have 1,3-bis trifluoromethylbenzene. Now, if you recall, using nitric acid in the presence of sulfuric acid is standard nitrating conditions. And so these tend to be weak electron withdrawing groups, but they should both be directing to the meta position. Since there's only one meta position available, nitration should occur there. Now in the final problem, we have oleum, which is a mixture of sulfur trioxide and sulfuric acid, in the presence of 1,3-bis-dichlorobenzene. Now, 1,3-dichlorobenzene has two chlorines, which are both very weak electron withdrawing groups, but they tend to be ortho-para directors. So we would anticipate that one sulfonyl group should be directed to the para position, because in general, ortho-para directors tend to go para if possible. Once this has been added, it's too electron deficient to add in another electrophile. However, if you added in something like nitric acid, you might still be able to add a nitro group here, because this would be para to this chloro, ortho to this chloro, as well as meta to the sulfonyl. So this would be something you could maybe do. Okay, now let's get into today's material. Carbonyl reductions using the Mozingo reduction, the Wolff-Kishner reduction, and the Clemmensen reduction. So, as you may recall from a couple episodes ago, Friedel-Crafts alkylations suck. And the reason for this is you have to use really harsh catalysts and you get frequent carbocation rearrangement reactions. Now, however, Friedel-Crafts acylation works relatively well, and so does Vilsmeier. Vilsmeier is rather mild. So what you could do is you can synthesize a ketone or an aldehyde and then reduce those groups to alkyl groups. So you're getting a net alkylation, however, it's just going through an acylation first. So the three main ways to do this are the Mozingo reduction, the Wolff-Kishner reduction, as well as the Clemmensen reduction. Now, personally, I am in favor of the Mozingo reduction, as you can do a lot of chemistry with diethionanes, such as in the case of the Corey-Seebach reaction. So what you could do if you wanted to like prepare a large library of similar compounds is do the Vilsmeier to prepare the aldehyde. So this would just do a selective aldehyde synthesis onto an arene, then make the diethiene using acid and a diethiol, then use Corey-Seebach chemistry and alkylate with a series of different alkylating agents. So the Mozingo reduction is as shown. So first we use stoichiometric rainy nickel. If we don't already have a diethiene, we have to synthesize it. And so we'll take a diethiol, and this is just like thioketylization, elimination of water with acid, will give us this 1,3-diethiene. Now we just treat it with rainy nickel, and this just cleaves any carbon sulfur bonds and puts hydrogen in their place. Now it's worth noting though that rainy nickel for other reductions can be used catalytically in the presence of hydrogen, but in this case, all of the nickel gets converted to nickel sulfide. Additionally, if we were to look at this following example, if we take an aldehyde directly and then just reduce that, we end up getting a methyl group. So if we have a ketone, we can get a disubstituted methylene. However, with an aldehyde, we get a methyl group. Now, a couple examples of the Mozingo reduction are as follows. Here you can see this complex natural product intermediate where they take this diethiene and they just reduce it to a CH2 in the presence of all these crazy functional groups. Another interesting example shown here where they have both an indole and an electron-rich arene and selectively reduce the diethiene using rainy nickel, both in very short reaction times and in decent conversions. Now, the Corey-Seebach reaction, as I mentioned briefly in one practice problem in a previous lecture, is you can lithiate a diethiene and then trap with an electrophile. So usually you can get away with something like LDA, but it just depends on what the diethiene is. So whatever the cyclic system is can change the pKa of this proton. And so this is a decently stable nucleophile, and you can trap it in situ. So this first case, we've just added in an alkylating agent, something like benzyl bromide, allyl bromide, bromobutane, that kind of thing, usually primary or secondary. If this video gets 150 likes, I will make a video about my research because I actually have made an analog of a diethion, which is much better for fluorination, reduction, and oxidation. I mean, with rainy nickel, it's basically the same, but in the case of unmasking it, it's a lot easier. So another cool reaction you could do is you could trap these out with ketones. So this is like a Grignard reaction, essentially, except we have this diethion retained. And so this is essentially an acyl ion equivalent. So you couldn't do the same reaction by deprotonating an aldehyde because that's a very unstable carbocation. So this lets you do some really neat chemistry that would be hard to do otherwise. In the case of this reaction here, this is a pretty neat product. Additionally, we could open up an epoxide and then we get the same type of products that we get if this was an aldol reaction. So if this was like acetophenone and this is some aldehyde, we'd get an aldol type product after unmasking this diethiene. Now, I'll just kind of like hammer home here why it's so useful. You can also take an acyl halide and then you get a ketone added, right? And then if you unmask this, you'd have a 1,2 diketone. You could also add in an imine and then you get an alpha amino group. So this is like a super duper useful reaction. Now the downside of the Corey-Seebach is for this diethiene, you usually have to unmask it using mercury salts. Sometimes they add in other additives such as silver or N-bromocyclamide, which can cause like a plethora of other products that are undesired. And so the one major disadvantage that this has is it's hard to unmask using silver or other oxidants. So you have to use mercury, and mercury salts are toxic. Okay, so if this video gets 150 likes, I'll make a video about my research where I disclose the structure of my diethiene, which you can actually unmask just using silver oxide. It just has to be fresh silver oxide, really easy. We're not planning on publishing this in the near future, so if I'm going to ever talk about it, it's going to be on this channel. So now we can talk about the Wolff-Kishner reduction. So if you're going to do a Wolff-Kishner, you typically have to do really high temperatures and really strong base, like potassium hydroxide. Now, normally potassium hydroxide is a fairly strong base, but these reactions typically occur at like 200 to 250 degrees Celsius. So these things are smoking hot, and potassium hydroxide is no joke at those temperatures, considering water boils at 100 degrees. Okay, so these just go through the intermediacy of a hydrazone, and then finally through the treatment of base, you get this CH2 group, and I'll show the mechanism in the next slide. There are other milder alternatives, such as tosylhydrazine, which also forms hydrazones even better. You can isolate them first. And then with something like sodium hydride, you usually get elimination at like 65 degrees sort of temperature. So a lot milder. So the mechanism of this reaction is as follows. First, the hydrazine is able to condense on the ketone and eliminate water, forming a hydrazone. Then the hydrazone can be deprotonated with base, and this allows a proton shift from this position to over here. Over here, we have the nitrogen collapse down, making a carbanion form. And finally, this can eliminate nitrogen, forming the carbanion that's treated with water, forming the CH2 product. Now, I think I have a couple of redundant spots here where this and this should just be gone, but that's okay. Now, some examples of this include the reduction of this triketone to this tricyclic benzo. Can't remember what this is called, but that's okay. Next, they also treated this other ketone with hydrazine, forming this fully reduced product as well. These are called indanes, just came back to my mind, indane. Okay, so the Clemmensen reduction is you take a ketone and you treat it with a zinc and mercury amalgam in the presence of HCl. This works typically best for aryl alkyl ketones, so at least one of the R groups usually should be aryl. However, there's cases where you can just reduce normal ketones to a CH2 using zinc powder or zinc wool, HCl gas, and diethyl ether. And the mechanism of this reaction isn't super clear. However, if you take the corresponding like secondary alcohol and treat it with these conditions, you don't get reduction. So the alcohol is not an intermediate, which is kind of interesting. So some examples of this include the reduction of this ketone in the presence of this carboxylic acid, it's not even touched. So this is kind of a cool thing you can do with the Clemmensen reduction, just totally ignore other functional groups. In this case, we also are able to selectively reduce the ketone in the presence of a lactone. Now, I might have mentioned it before, but lactones tend to be a little bit more sensitive than acids or esters because there's some strain in that bond, and it just makes it easier for nucleophiles to add. So for this lecture, I'd like to assign a few practice problems. First, I'd like to assign the treatment of this epoxide with this diethiene. If you can figure out what the joke is behind this 5-membered ring heterocycle, post it in the comments and I'll pin the first person to get it. Once you obtain this product, it's treated with rainy nickel, and you should draw the structure of both the intermediate and the final product. In the next problem, I want you to show a possible starting material for the following reaction. So on the right, we have this reduced compound. We have hydrazine in the presence of ethylene glycol, heat, and KOH. So this is a Wolff-Kishner reduction. But the question is, what would the starting material be? In addition, once you figure out the structure of this starting material, what would you obtain if you treated it with rainy nickel instead? And if you can't figure out what would happen, I'd encourage you to check out this paper from Thomas Hoy's lab. Now, in this final problem, this is a multi-step synthesis problem, and I figured it would be good to do a little bit more practice of this with you guys. So first, we take this electron-rich arene, treat it with acetyl chloride and aluminum trichloride. Subsequently, we treat that product with LDA. Then we treat that product with benzyl bromide. And finally, we treat this with a zinc amalgam and HCl. And so this is a Clemmensen reduction. So draw the structure of the final product. In the next lecture, when we go through this problem, I'll draw the structures of the intermediates as well. And so with that, I hope that this has been a useful video on the reduction of carbonyls, specifically ketones and aldehydes, to CH2s and CH3s. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them below, and it would really help out if you left this video a like and subscribed. Have a great day.